Alex again with another deck profile. I've pretty much been hating the game right now. I love playing Yu-Gi-Oh! I just don't like the game as it is right now. Anyway, that aside, I'm making another deck profile because my friend of the channel, in THA sack, in the sack, he calls himself, said that I should start making YouTube videos again, so I'm gonna do a couple. Shout out to you. Anyway, I was thinking about just how I could not lose to every single deck in the game. All of the top tier decks, every time I run into them, I'm like, ugh, I hate this. So I kind of formulated a deck that I like playing, and at the same time that I have most of the cards for in real life, and at the same time was also okay against all of the meta decks. And I started to look at its matchups, and I think that Nimble Frogs is quite a good deck. I guess I'll just go through the deck list, and then we'll talk about it again. First, we've got 3 Obelisk the Tormentors. Doesn't really die. I've drawn it dead once, but I actually managed to play 2 in the game, so it wasn't a huge problem. 3 Coelacanth, and I don't understand why Nimble players don't run this. It's phenomenal. It accomplishes the same thing that the rest of the deck does, only it does it better. It's really good. Heart and Soul of the deck, Nimble Angler. More like the lungs or the intestines of the deck, Nimble Mimanga, and Nimble Sunfish is kind of like important. But anyway, aside from the body metaphors, we've got 3 Tidal, 3 Swat Frog. They're the primary engine in the deck for dumping Nimble Angler to the graveyard. But I'll explain that in a bit. 3 Dupe Frog. Some people run 2 or even 1, but I really don't like that. It feels cloggy to me. It feels like my hands get cloggier when I don't have as many searchers as I can. I even considered, and it's a bad idea, so don't do it, running Mother Grizzly. Don't do that. You don't need Swat Frog that bad in this deck. Then 2 Ronin-Tonin. Really, really good in this deck. Like, it changes your plays where you make, like, 2 rank 7s or something like that into, like, 3 rank 7s. Or not 3 rank 7s, like 2 rank 7s and like a rank 2. And it's really good. Or if you only can make a rank 6, you might be able to make a rank 7. Or if you can only make a rank 5, yeah, you get the point. Exodius, the Forbidden Lord. Now, this guy's really good because you burn through all of these frogs in like a turn. With any reasonable hand, by turn 2, you normally have blown through most of your frogs in the deck. Or most of your fish in the deck. It happens. There's like 9 cards in here, and 3 searchers for those cards that just dump frogs into the graveyard. And this guy, He's also got a really cool second effect, which is a foolish burial. So when he attacks... okay, so here's a really good play. Even though he starts out with zero attack, when he attacks, you get to throw out a card from your deck. After you put back all of your fish by special summoning him with his effect, you can dump Nimble Angler to the graveyard. Special summon a Nimble Demanga and a Nimble Sunfish, and then you have enough tributes for Coelacanth, you have enough tributes for Obelisk, you have enough tributes for Light and Darkness if you want to run him. In another format, I would run Light and Darkness over him, but since it's a Tier 0 format we're in right now, no chance of that happening. Then, another really cool play with him is that if you do have an Obelisk, you can drop him and then overlay for the really huge level 12 guy, or level... Are these level 12s? I might be wrong about this play, since I don't run it. So I'm not going to talk about it. It also makes easy rank 4s when you attack, drop the Nimble Angler, special summon these two, and the next card here, Lemuria, is on the field. Lemuria, pretty much, you don't need it to make the deck run, but when the deck has it on the field, it runs really, really, really broke. That's why I have two terraformings, because it's not essential. It's not like without it you lose the game, but it is easier. Now, I want to put a Treeborn in here, too. I should probably explain what Lemuria does. So, this card is treated as Umi, so, like, I don't know, if you want to blow up the field or something with the Leviathan Dragon, one of my favorite cards in the entire game of Yu-Gi-Oh, even though it's really not meta. So you could blow up the field if you want to run one of those as tech. All water monsters gain 200 attack and defense. Okay, that's nifty. Why am I running it? Well, this part. Once per turn during your main phase, you can have all water monsters on the field you currently control gain levels equal to the number of water monsters you currently control until the end phase. This pretty much makes the deck work. You have Swamp Frog and Nimble Angler, and I know if you have Swamp Frog, Nimble Angler, and Lemuria, you can technically do like 10,000 damage. But I don't really like that combo. It's just not for me. Whatevs. Plus, I'm never gonna get two of these M7 cards. They're like $20. Anyway. So you have Lemuria here. You drop Nimble Angler with Swap Frog. You throw out, a Ronin Tonin. You put this guy right here, the Nimble Mamanga, and the Sunfish onto the field. Then, right now, with Lemuria, you have three on the field. Well, you still haven't normal summoned. So, right now, you could tribute for Obelisk if you have it. If you tribute for Coelacanth, then bounce the Swap Frog, then you have a ditch target for Coelacanth. And then you can special summon four more, and then make two rank sevens, if you want. Or, if you don't have either of those cards, then... And if you drop Obelisk against E-Dragons, or whatever they're called, Dragon Rulers, You drop them against Dragon Rulers, and they pretty much have no out. Like, you can just beat them to death because they don't run anything that doesn't target. They don't even main Dark Hole. Yeah. So, yeah. Unfortunately, E-Dragon players have kind of picked up on Obelisk and the guy that just won the YCS. I don't remember which one it was, but he was running two Obelisk the Tormentors in his side deck. So he would just side these in game two when he was up against the Dragon Rulers matchup, and then just Dragosack tribute for Obelisk, and then it was like, what are they going to do? Yeah, anyway. I'm talking about a combo. So right now you have three on the field. You haven't normal summoned, so you bounce Swamp Frog back to your hand, summon it again, and throw out something that you can use with Ronin Toten. Say for instance Dupe Frog. So you throw out Dupe Frog. So now you have four, or you have three on the field. Then you bring back the Ronin Toten. Then you have five on the field. Wait, hold on. Swamp Frog, Nimble Angler, those two. So that's three. Bounce three, that goes to two, three, four. Sorry, I have to think out the numbers here. Then it goes to four. Yeah, with the Ronin Toten. You play Lemuria, and you have two rank sixes. You can just drop, like, a Bouncer or, you know, one of the other really good rank sixes, because there are a couple good ones. In that situation, you also have, like, complete control over stuff. It's not like you're limited here. You can also overlay for a 2, and then overlay for a 5 in that situation. Yeah, anyway. Moving on, because you need to get to your Lemuria, I run 2 Terraformings. Pot of Avarice, because you need it. Like, I'm almost considering running a third of him. If it wasn't so cloggy, I would run a third of him. But, I don't know. You need this. This card is super helpful. In fact, I wish that there was a send 10 back for the exact same effect, because I want to put back my my fish. I want to put back the Obelisk. I want to put back the Coelacanth. I want to put back all the Xyz, and it ends up with me just putting back the fish, because that needs to happen. Monster Reborn, obvious. Dark Hole, bad, but I'm running it, because I know that after this format, people are still going to view this video. And they're going to be like, why is that guy not running Dark Hole? And I'll be like, well, I am running Dark Hole, because, yeah, blah, blah, blah. And then Heavy Storm, because Heavy Storm, and I'm running a combo-based deck. And 3 MST. Now, this deck could run traps, and I'm considering putting traps in, but not right now. Like, in another format, I could see myself pulling out the Obelisk the Tormentors for, like, 3 traps that beat the meta. At the same time, I could also see running 1 Treeborn instead of one of the MSTs. I just kept hitting decks that weren't, like, the main decks of the format. So, yeah, I just was running the MSTs because of that, but otherwise, I could easily see running 2 or even 1 MST just because of the fact that it's not as good right now as it could be. In fact, if there is the consideration of just pulling them all into the sideboard. I could see myself also pulling the obelisks in a different format for max Cs, because they are very good in this deck. Like, every single draw you make makes you closer and closer to having one of these 9 cards. Effect Feeler, I just pulled it out, but it is really good. You drop it on Dragosac when they try to turn one Lad, because there is only one deck this format, despite what Konami is trying to feed us that, oh no, Evil Sworns is a deck. Well, no. We could see by the last YCS results that every single top table, except I think one, had Dragon Rulers in it. Props to the guy that was running Constellars at table 8. I mean, I don't know how he did that. Did he just drop his Constellar guy turn 1, and then every time they tried to Dragosac, he was just like, put it back in your hand, bitch. I mean, that's the only thing that I could see. Triple Nightbeam in a trap heavy format, I would seriously recommend running 3 MSG, running 3 Nightbeam also, because it is a combo based deck. If your combos are getting cock blocked, you're not going to get much done. They're going to solemn you, they're going to get rid of your shit somehow. Again, Lad in a different format, you could run it, but this format, not really. I mean, it's good against Dax, it's good against Evil Sworns, but, I mean, it's good against pretty much all the non-meta decks, so any randoms that you run into, you could possibly sideboard. Vanity's Fiend is something that is not in this extra deck, but should be, for the Dragon Ruler matchup, because I can tribute, like, a lot, and then they're like, oh, so you dropped a Vanity's Fiend. I guess I'm gonna scoop this one up. So, yeah, that's another thing to consider. Moulin Glacier, again, in another format, you dump 5 instantly. You dump 5 instantly. There's nothing in your way from dropping Moulin Glacier. You could run 2 or even 3 of this guy in a different format. But again, we're in a tier 0 format, so I'm just mentioning it. I wanted to put the third Gachi Gachi in. Actually, I should probably go over the extra deck this time, because it's not just a self-explanatory blah like, you know, some extra decks are, like frogs. Gotcha Gotcha, I run 2, I want to put it to 3. Dark Mist, I run 1, I want to put it to 2. Just for the times when I don't have Lemuria on the field. Which, you know, it happens. I mean, this is only 5 cards in the deck. That's like 1 in 6 chance of drawing it. Yeah. From simple statistical standpoints. Anyway. No. It's, 10 would be... You know what? It doesn't matter. It's only 5 cards, so, yeah, it's... If you had 10 target slash searchers, you would be, like, 1 in 4, so it would be 1 in 8. I'm wrong. Anyway. Oh, God bless it. Or damn it. Either one. Sorry, guys. Been babbling on for at least 10 minutes now. Back to what we were talking about. Levier, almost never make it, but it needs to be here. I mean, I never make rank 3s. They're in here because they're in here. I'm probably actually going to pull these out. Like, I've made a rank 3 zero times. Levolval Chain, really good. Really good in this deck. Like, you play a Lemuria, you do your standard frog play, where normally you would make a Gachi Gachi in frogs, where you would drop a dupe to the graveyard, and then normal summon to throw the Ronin, special summon the Ronin, then play Levolval Chain, and then you can just be like, okay, drop Nimble Angler to the graveyard by detaching, I don't know, Ronin to special summon two more, and then you can overlay for whatever 4-star you decide to put in. It's really, this is kind of all up to kind of how you want to play. And I wish that I had more extra deck space, but I actually like that it's so restrictive for this deck, because otherwise, yeah, it would just have all the outs. I run a Symphony to Djinn. It's player preference, really. And I don't own a Diamond Dyer. Diamond Dyer would work in this deck, but I don't know. It's not really worth it for me. Even though I also run Infernities, which I'll probably be profiling after this. Vulcasaurus. Can make this easily. I could make Vulcasaurus, and then this with 3,000 attack, and a Gachi on board. No problem. It's not an issue for this deck. It's pretty easy. Tyrus, pretty good. I mean, it lives through everything. So, that's a thing. And it's got a whopping 2,600 attack. Wind up, Zen Fag. Yeah, he's good. I'm happy I traded mine off at $20, and then traded for one again, and then traded it off at $20, and then traded for one, and now I just need to get one, and it's like $10. But yeah. I made him against Chainburn, and they pretty much lost their shit, because they were like, well, I guess. Yeah. Because they couldn't set more than one card, which means, yeah. I think that with Chainburn you would be able to play out of it, but maybe he just got a bad hand. Who knows? Rank 6s make these a lot. Photon Strike Bouncer. And Grenade Launcher, or whatever its face is called. Yeah, they're both good. This one pops two cards, this one negates effects, it's good. I probably make this more than anything else, this Abystius. It's really good, really, really easy to drop. Like, I want to run two, but at the same time, I also need room for this, and the room's probably going to come out of these two spots. I'm probably going to put in two of these and two of these so I can do the 10,000 point OTK. Or not 10,000 points. Wait. Yeah, 10,000 points. And attack for way over game, even through like a 2,000 beater or something. That's probably what I'm going to do with the extra deck. And then Gaia Charger, another one that I really feel like I should be running two of, but I only have space for one. Alright, now that that's done, we'll talk about how Lord of the Tekkion Galaxy has affected this deck. Because, as you know, it affects a lot of decks that have a lot of elements in them. For instance, Lovels, Mermails, etc. This deck is also affected. With Tidal, and Tidal is really good in this deck, in fact, so much so that I want to run two of the babies and three three of the gold sarks. Just so that I can... maybe not the babies, but at least the gold sarks. So that way I can special, or I can, you know, drop this to send Nimble Angler from the deck to the graveyard, because it will get its effect. It's not a Mermail. This is just whenever it's sent to the hand, or from this hand, when it's sent from the hand or deck to the graveyard, you can special summon this card with... Yeah, you can special summon two level 2 or lower Nimble monsters. Level 3 or lower. Wow, I cannot read. Which has never been more apparent than with that last card reading. Ugh. Anyway. Title is pretty epic in this deck. It pretty much tutors the whole deck, kind of. I mean, you can... Swap Frog also makes the deck really good. Like, if you have Swap Frog and Nimble Angler, you can do 10,000 damage. Yeah. I don't want to go over the play. There's another guy. If you search out, Forgotten City OTK, you'll find a really easy tutorial on that. Now, I don't understand why people cut this from the deck. From all of the plays that I've made with this card, they have all resulted in me winning the game. I mean, hands down, this is the MVP. Hands down. I mean, this deck produces 3 tributes, 4 tributes, 5 tributes for nothing. You can play him at any point in the game. Overlay your space away, and then get like a plus 3 or a plus 4. It's amazing. Or, no, a plus 2 or a plus 3, because you have to discard a card for his effect. Yeah. And you can even tribute off powerful cards like Title, and still have it worth it to use him. Because you can drop 7, and you can drop Launcher in, like, the same play. Or you can drop Mermail, the Mermail guy, and you can drop M7, which you can use to add, like, Swap Frog back to your hand. It's insane! Or you can use it to put Nimble Angler back to your hand. It's so good. I can't say enough good things about this card. The only downside to Coelacanth, and I'm going to click something so I don't time out again, is that you do lose 4 fish from your deck. I mean, that's the only thing that kind of ruins it, because then you... Like I said, you go through your fish too fast. Too fast. You can't slow them down because you just keep making awesome plays with them. Yeah. Like, okay. So, let me give you a common scenario. First turn, you have Coelacanth. It's always worth it to go for Coelacanth. Unless, of course, you're playing E-Dragons, which always drop the Obelisk first. But you have Coelacanth and a Swap Frog and, like, 2 Waters or something. If you have Nimble Angler, even better. But, yeah, you bring him out by tributing off whatever you need to, and then you special summon 4 of these by discarding something. Always worth it to do. Because you get a plus 4... And you get to drop cards that your opponent just can't deal with a lot of the time. Like, if you wanted to, you could drop Tyrus, which we all know from the last... Well, we might not all know, but there was another frog deck that topped, and I really like that one, too. And I'm so torn. It was Tadpole Frogs? that topped it topped German nationals. It got like top four, and he was running Tadpole. Nobody runs Tadpole. And then he was running the dupe frogs, the straight up dupe frogs, not the cards that are considered dupe frog. No, dupe frogs. And he was overlaying with them for fives, and I was like, oh, that's so cool. Because nobody had done it. Yeah. Props to him. Anyway, back onto this deck. Coelacanth, always worth dropping. Like, straight up, you can drop fives, you can drop sixes, you can drop sevens, you can drop twos. I mean, even a Coelacanth with, like, a Dark Mist on the field is hard for decks to deal with. My favorite play is dropping this and an M7 in the same turn, and they're like, well, fuck. Yeah. I always thought M7 should be a level 7. Because that's how the OTK works. You have two level 6s. Right. Right. Stupid brain. Yeah, so you overlay for two of the M7s, and then you use it to get back a Nimble Angler and a Swap Frog. Durr. I'm dumb. Anyway. M7 is a great card in this deck. And you can drop this guy without Lemuria on the field. That's not even hard, because you got these guys. If you get two of these guys in your hand, and it's kind of later game, you're like, well, special. And then they're like, oh, well, fuck. Then you overlay with these two guys and keep going. This deck is really fast, too. Always keep track of how many fish you have in your deck, because that will matter. The other build of this that I saw, and this is probably going to be the last thing I talk about before I close up. The other build that I saw was running Undines and Mermil Abyss Pike. And it was using it to drop stuff to the graveyard, i.e. Nimble Angler, to add things like the Undine from your deck to your hand, so you always had a searchable way to get it, I think. I don't know. I didn't look at that one too hard, because I really wanted to make a Coelacanth deck that could also drop Obelisk. Yeah, and this deck is pretty versatile. I mean, you can side into what you need. It's like frogs, but with less frogs. And I know I do too many frog deck profiles on my channel, which is why I'm going to throw up my Infernity deck profile relatively soon. Probably today, or maybe sometime this week. Alright, well, peace out, YouTube. If you like this video, make sure to tell me so. If you think that, hey, you're doing this deck wrong, or, wow, that's a cool tech, make sure you leave it in the comments, because I love reading the comments. It's the only reason I do YouTube videos. That's all I got to say. So, yeah, if you've made it this far, congrats. You get a sticker. Catch you guys later.